Hello and welcome to Veterans Perspective. My name is Tom Gellis, a former Marine officer, and today I am privileged to have State Senator Guy Reschenthaler representing the 37th District here in Western Pennsylvania. Guy, welcome to the show.
Tom, thanks for having me. I appreciate it.
My understanding is that you, and I'm having you on the show because you are a former Navy officer.
Yes.
And a former JAG officer in the Navy. What I like to do with my guests in my show is to take them back to where they're from and let them tell their story. That's the purpose of my show.
Okay.
Tell your story about your time in the service and what you think the folks in my audience will find interesting. So
okay.
Where are you from, Guy? So,
well, I'm born and raised in the South Hills, went to TJ High School, and then I went to Penn State Barron for undergrad. Right after undergrad, went to Duquesne Law School. And from Duquesne, that's where I got into the Navy.
The programs, was there a program at Duquesne that allowed you to get into the Navy pipeline?
So there's three ways to get into the Navy JAG Corps. The most popular way is called the student program, and that's where the Navy takes somebody who is just done with their first year in law school. And then that person applies, and then there's a series of boards, and they get accepted, and they get commissioned. And then either between their second and third year of law school, they go to officer development school, or they go after they've taken the bar exam. But they're commissioned as an officer in the Navy.
And that was after your first year of law school. So were you commissioned and still attending law school at Duquesne?
Yes. So I was commissioned while I was in law school. I went directly to officer development school in Newport, Rhode Island. And then when I was at officer development school, I found out that I had passed the bar, which was an interesting experience to be in officer development school and figure out I passed the bar. But it was fun. And then I went to Naval Justice School, which is like an extra semester of law school where you learn about rules of engagement, military procedure, and so forth. It's law that's particular to the service. And then I went to Norfolk, Virginia, which was my first duty station.
Now, for my audience, I believe that I knew the acronym IRR, Individual Ready Reserve.
Yes, I'm sorry.
That's okay.
We talk in alphabetic soup
in
the military, so right.
And then was the Officer Development School the same or a little bit different than Officer's Candidate School, or were you mixed in with those same guys?
No, we weren't. So I dare say Officer Development School was fairly easy compared to Officer Candidate School. Officer Candidate School was at Newport, Rhode Island as well, but Officer Development School is for individuals that already have a commission.
Okay.
And you have, so doctors, lawyers, dentists, chaplains, nuclear scientists, JAGs. It's more the professional corps. Now, it wasn't easy, but it also wasn't like officer candidate school. I personally loved it. I was getting paid to run, lift weights, learn about military history, and how to wear a uniform. I couldn't believe I was getting paid for that. It was all things that I liked. In fact, I didn't want to leave officer development school. I liked it that much.
And again, that was in Newport?
Newport, Rhode Island.
Okay. And now, did you march in formations? Did you have any military background prior to getting your commission?
No, prior to getting I had always wanted to be in the military. So ever since I was a little kid, I wanted to be a military officer of some sort. I then found out going into the eighth grade, I wanted to be a lawyer or a military officer. Going into the eighth grade, I figured out that I could do both in the JAG Corps. So going into the eighth grade, I knew I wanted to be a JAG, particularly in the Navy. But other than wanting to be in the Navy, I had no experience in the military up until I got into officer development school.
Now, for me, it was second lieutenant. Did you get something higher than ensign when you got your commission?
No. So I got commissioned as an ensign, which is, as you know, is an O-1. When we graduated officer development school, either that or Naval Justice School, I forget which, we all got an automatic promote to O-2, lieutenant junior grade. And then from a year from that point, you got an automatic promotion to O-3, lieutenant. And I got out as a lieutenant.
Okay. Now, and that's when you deployed overseas and you went over as a lieutenant.
I did. I was a lieutenant when I was in Iraq.
And then for our audience, the lieutenant is the one with the double bars, or called railroad tracks.
That's right. That's
and
right.
then for the comparable, a captain in the Marine Corps.
Yes.
So a captain in the Marine Corps is a lieutenant in the Navy.
Yes.
So you go through your officer's development school. You go to Norfolk. Now, give me a time frame on this now, Guy. Is it early 2000s, or when is this?
I got commissioned in 2006. 2007, I went to officer development school in the summer. Graduated Naval Justice School in 2008. 2008 to the spring of 2009, I was in Norfolk, Virginia. I was doing what's called legal assistance. So anything a sailor, marine, or Coast Guardsman might need, I was taking care of it. So wills, powers of attorney, consumer law issues, small criminal defense matters, things like that. Then I had requested on numerous occasions to deploy to Iraq. The first day I reported to Naval Legal Service Office in Norfolk, I told my commanding officer, I'm happy to be here, but I really want to be in Iraq. I just really wanted to go. I really wanted to be forward deployed. And you couldn't deploy typically until you'd been in for a year. So almost a year, or active for a year. On almost the exact yearly date that I got to my command, I was then selected to go to Baghdad. And I was very, very fortunate because there was no guarantee, but I screened to be a prosecutor when I went to Baghdad. So I went to Baghdad. I was at the Central Criminal Court of Iraq, which was the federal court system in Baghdad. So it was in the red zone. So I made daily trips into the red zone, and I prosecuted terrorists and insurgents before Iraqi judges using Iraqi law through an interpreter. And it was an amazing experience. I prosecuted roughly 100 terrorists, had 92 convictions. I had 15 death penalty cases and had 13 death penalty convictions. And that was in 2009.
When you went to court and you got your convictions, now these individuals, did they stay in Iraq? Did they get sent to Guantanamo Bay? Or who was enforcing the penalty?
Right. So they were in our theater internment facilities. That's what we now call POW camps.
Okay.
So they were in our theater internment facilities. But if we were to release the terrorists and they still had time on their sentence, then they would go into Iraqi prisons.
Okay.
They never. It was amazing to see grown men, terrorists, break down into tears, because when they went to the Iraqi prisons, they would destroy them. Their standard of living was atrocious. The average life expectancy in an Iraqi prison is 7 years. So you can imagine, it was horrible. But that was the way it was. At that time, we were the kinetic operations were winding down, but the legal operations were winding up. So it was a great time to be there as a prosecutor. But also, we were starting to release a lot of the lower level terrorists. And when they got released in the Iraqi prison system, it was very traumatic for them.
For the benefit of the audience now, were you in what they called the green zone? Was there a green zone there in Iraq?
Tom, great question. So yes and no. Here's why. When I got to Baghdad in the spring of 2009, it was still the green zone, which there were a bunch of T-walls around the green zone. The green zone, downtown Baghdad was roughly the size of Pittsburgh plus Oakland, to put it in perspective for Pittsburghers. But then in June of that year, we handed over the green zone to the Iraqis, so it went into Iraqi control. And then it became what's called the IZ, the international zone. And we retracted to small forward operating bases that may be a few city blocks by a few city blocks. But as soon as you would step off the base, that was technically the red zone. The court was always in the red zone. But what was different when we went from the green zone to the IZ was that literally when you stepped off the base, that was the red zone. And then we had a 3-day stand down. I still remember it. It was somewhat chaotic. But when we handed over the city to the Iraqis, we had no idea what was going to happen. So it was an interesting time to be in Iraq during that time.
I want to go back just a little bit, yeah, because we threw out another acronym that some of my audience might not know, JAG.
Yes.
And when you want to expound on it, JAG.
Sure. So the JAG is Judge Advocate General's Corps. And so George Washington started it. And what it was every service has a JAG Corps. And they're the military officers who are lawyers. So the prosecutors, defense attorneys, they do rules of engagement, international law, et cetera. So the Coast Guard, the Marines, Navy, Air Force, we all have JAGs. And in the way the JAGs, the community works, is you have the Sea Service JAGs, then you have Air Force and Army JAGs. So so we all work together in the water services. So it wouldn't be uncommon for me to represent Coast Guardsmen, Marines, and sailors, and the people working alongside of me. It could be a Marine, it could be a Coastie. The Sea Services are all together, and the court system is all together. So our appellate system goes through, it's called the Navy Marine Corps appellate system. So we're all in that branch.
And did you all work together over there in Iraq? Were you mixed with Army JAG, Air Force JAG? Were there a multiple JAG
It was. It was what we would call purple. It was a joint command, but I was with Task Force 134. It was an Army command, so I was dressed in Army combat uniform, and we had Army insignia on us. All the Army standards applied to us, but there were no Army officers.
Now, I hate to do this again, but I'm gonna take you back. What was it like when you got the word that you were going to deploy? What was the scenario? What was the logistics in getting you from Norfolk? And another question I had was, were you married at the time?
No, I've never been married, no kids.
Okay.
And I was very, very young. So I started school a year early. I graduated college a year early. I was the second youngest member of my law school class. And I believe I was the youngest at my Naval Justice School class. I was certainly the youngest when I went to Iraq. But so I was 20, I think 4, 25, somewhere in that range. I think I was like 25. But anyhow, I got word that I was going to deploy to Baghdad. I, of course, was very, very excited. My parents were not so excited.
Yeah, but I can imagine.
But we went to NIAC, Navy IA Combat Training. So it's a way to get individuals ready from the Navy to go to Iraq and Afghanistan. And again, I forget how long it was, but I loved every minute of it. You know, I was getting paid to roll around the dirt, shoot guns, run, work out, learn about how to be on a convoy. And again, I was getting paid for it. It was incredible. I just loved it. But we did things like live convoy training, M16 shooting, first aid. And of course, we worked out a lot. It was a lot of fun. At least I had a lot of fun. But so we went from combat training. We then went to the Udari range in Kuwait to get acclimated. And we did live convoy training to get used to how to do convoys. And then it was, I remember it was really bizarre. I was with somebody who was with me from Officer Development School, Naval Justice School. He was at my command in Norfolk. We'd always been together our entire career. And we went into a room to talk to the CO there. And he said, "Guy, you're going to downtown Baghdad at Forward Operating Base Union 3. You're going to be a prosecutor." And they told my friend he was going to work on some intel project, and he was going to stay at Camp Cropper, which is a really big base in Iraq. And it was really bizarre because I had always been with this guy, and I think he wanted to be a prosecutor too, but it just worked out that he needed to work in intel. And then I got on an MRAP and went right into downtown Baghdad and got dropped off. I mean, it was that fast.
The MRAP, that's that bigger vehicle that we would see on TV, is that correct?
It's a bigger vehicle, and the bottom of it is bowed out. So okay. If there is an explosion, the force is distributed.
And I know you were young.
Right.
And I know you wanted to be there. But when you went from point A to point B, especially on the roads, how much was that in your head as somebody that's been there, worrying about an IED going off?
It was a constant worry, but the way I looked at it was, if it's going to happen, it's going to happen. I got a job to do, and there's nothing that I could do by worrying about it. So someone did get hit in an IED. Two of our members of the command did get hit. I don't want to talk too much about it, but even after that, you just had to put it behind you and just say it could happen at any time. And then our base would get mortared because what would happen was from Sadr City, they would fire to try to hit the embassy, which was literally right across the street from FOB Union 3, where I was stationed, and it would overshoot. So sometimes that would happen, but again, you can't dwell on that. You just have to put your head down and do your job and realize if it's gonna happen, it's gonna happen. But again, I wasn't in a combat role, but I was in downtown Baghdad.
Right.
But so you just had to move on and not worry about it.
When you went out, were you considered a non-combatant as a JAG officer?
No, I wasn't. Okay. So we were armed. So I would have a sidearm in court all the time, and an M4, M16, sometimes when we were on convoys or moving. But we had a lot of mastered arms that were guarding us. I felt fairly secure when we were going to court. Once we got into court, there weren't enough MAs to cover everybody. And then I picked up Arabic rather quickly, so I was able to go on my own. And I knew numbers, I knew how to say simple phrases, so I could get my case ready, the paperwork to the judge, I can communicate with the locals to get where I needed to get. So there were a lot of times where I was literally the only American in the room around.
No kidding.
And then, yeah, it was something else. And then we sometimes would take two trips from my base to the court. So my interpreter sometimes would stay behind because they couldn't fit, because the officer in charge knew that I could at least handle my own for the first 45 minutes or so and do what I needed to do. And it got to the point where when I got to Baghdad, I was put in a room. There wasn't enough space where all the Americans were sitting. So I was put in a room with the linguists. And they, of course, spoke Arab as a first language, right? So they didn't want to speak English because that was their second language. So the only time that I was with Americans speaking English or Brits or Aussies was when I was either eating or working out. So I that's how I picked it up so quickly, because they would not speak English to me. And then when they found out that I was picking it up quickly, they started to really teach me. So when we went out, they would point to things and say the Arabic words. So I became proficient. I don't want to overstate it. I could hold my own.
How were you accepted as an American over there at that time frame?
Believe it or not, we were accepted really well. So you have to understand that in downtown Baghdad, it was much more Western and much more secular. I felt like the attorneys in the Iraqi court system really held the Americans and the Brits and the Aussies in high regard. They had just had a lot of respect for common law. And so we were treated very, very fairly. I felt, though, that once you had individuals from the provincial areas, they looked at us more skeptically than others. But that upper, you understand, there, I don't want to say it's a caste system, but their society is more broken down. But the higher you are in that system, typically the more Western, the more pro-American you were. So I felt like we were treated very well. I would eat a lot of times breakfast, lunch, and dinner with my Iraqi prosecutor counterparts. I mean, I got to know them very well.
Who were the defending attorneys then whenever you were prosecuting?
So the terrorists could purchase or hire, I should say, they could hire their own defense attorney, or they would have a public defender assigned to them. And I always knew if our intel was correct or not, because if I had somebody that was showing on my intel report as a low risk, but they a small fish, but they had the Iraqi top defense attorney, right? I knew that we were making a mistake because somebody was paying. Al-Qaeda wasn't going to waste money on some low-level guy, right? They were going to let the public defender take care of him. And then I got to know the Al-Qaeda defense attorneys because you got to know who they were. They were very prominent. I mean, Baghdad is not that big of a city. Again, it's about the size of Pittsburgh plus Oakland. So you got to know the big players. And so you could tell where people were in the terrorist pecking order by who was representing them. Again, Baghdad was very Western, so all the judges wore suits. The clerks all wore suits and ties. The women, you could tell who was, you could tell a lot by the hijab, the headscarf. If it was black, it was more likely they were wearing it for religious reasons, but if it was polka dot or pink or leopard print or something crazy, they still wanted to be stylish and they were wearing that hijab in protest. So you could start to read how people were dressed and their affiliation. Now, if you got somebody from the provincial area, they would come in the flowing robes. But again, most of the people I was dealing with were in suits and ties. And again, they a lot of them did speak English because Saddam had English taught in the schools. But Arabic was what was spoken in court.
The individuals that you prosecuted, were they purely individuals that conducted or perpetrated against Americans, crimes against Americans? Were they off the battlefield? Were they in the city? Was it petty crime type stuff? What did
So it was all of the above. So the Statute of Forces Agreement called a SOFA allowed the Americans, and I should say the coalition forces, it allowed the coalition forces to prosecute anybody who had aggrieved a member of the coalition forces. Okay. So I started off doing fake ID cases. We think that's not a big deal. In Iraq, it's indicative of terrorist activity. Plus, if I could show use, if I could show possession, that was 2 years. Use was 5 years. They serve consecutively. So they serve the 2 years first, then the 5 years. Well, that's important because, again, the average life expectancy in an Iraqi prison is 7 years. So if I could show use and possession of a fake ID, it was tantamount to a death penalty conviction. And then I did acts of terrorism, planting IDs, et cetera. And then the biggest case I had was a 15 co-defendant murder case where 15 inmates killed another detainee, another terrorist. They were instituting Sharia law in the prison facility, and it was a gruesome, horrific murder, and I prosecuted the terrorists. I had two plea deals with two of them, so I get the death penalty on the other 13. Really proud of that.
Were they all in the court at the same time?
No, so it was individual. Yes and no. So they were all in the actual physical court at the same time, but even though the case was together, we had one at a time. The Iraqi court system is different. So there's no juries. A lot of it's done. It's called the inquisitorial system. So it's a little different. They weren't quote unquote convictions. They're called detention orders, which are the equivalent of convictions. And then their trial court, what they call the trial court, is basically a sentencing court that upholds the detention orders, the convictions. And then, so that was 2009. I went back to Norfolk at the end of 2009, around Halloween of 2009. I was assigned a case with a Navy SEAL who was falsely accused of punching a terrorist in the face. Well, that terrorist was Ahmed Hashim Abdullah Sawi, who's now famous as the Butcher of Fallujah.
I'll be darned.
So when I was in Iraq, I had nothing to do with the capture. I was only prosecuting Special Forces captures. I had nothing to do with capturing the terrorists. But SEAL Team 10 had captured the Butcher of Fallujah. The Butcher of Fallujah said that he was abused, he was punched. He had a litany of things that he said happened to him. So I went back to Iraq in 2010. This time I was a defense attorney in U.S. federal court in Baghdad. So I'm one of the few attorneys that's actually prosecuted in Iraqi federal court and U.S. federal court in Iraq. But so I was a defense attorney. I cross-examined the Butcher of Fallujah. It was a 45-minute cross, showed that he was lying, exaggerating. I impeached him, shredded the government's case apart. My client was fully acquitted. He's back on the SEAL teams now. I was then a consultant on the next two cases. Those SEALs were fully acquitted. There's a book written about it called Honor and Betrayal by Patrick Robinson. It's a good read. I know that's self-serving because I'm in the book, but it's a good read. It's called Honor and Betrayal. Honor and Betrayal by Patrick Robinson.
Okay.
I recommend it. And it mentions Pittsburgh, Duquesne Law School. It's a good book.
The guy, when he was the butcher, if I can refer to him as that, when he was on the stand, were you conversing in Arabic?
So that's interesting. No, so I didn't want the Butcher of Fallujah to know who I was because he would have known that. Put it this way, they would have known me, okay?
Okay.
So when I first started talking to the Butcher of Fallujah, I made it a point to strip my uniform. So I took off all the insignia, et cetera. I then went in and questioned him. I also told all the guards, I said, look, you're not going to like what I have to say. I'm just trying to elicit information. And the guard said, we know what you're doing. And the guards knew me because I had just been in Iraq a few months earlier. But I did not let the terrorists know that I had any proficiency in Arabic, and it really helped because it gave me extra time to think. It also made me I could kind of read if the translator was, you know, playing it straight. But it worked out because the terrorist ended up believing that I was his attorney. So he gave me a lot more information, exaggerated a lot more than I had ever anticipated, ever dreamt of. I then did witness prep with the terrorist in the courtroom, where I brought him in, made him sure he felt made him feel like he was comfortable, explained where the court was, and again, playing dumb the entire time. And then when it got time for the actual trial, the prosecutor was using real long sentences, complex language. That the interpreter was Egyptian, it's a different dialect, so stuff was getting lost in translation. It got so bad that the Butcher of Fallujah kept on looking at me almost for help. I just kind of put my head down and looked away because I didn't want the jury to know that I had a connection with the butcher. And then I got up and used short, choppy sentences, very plain English, which really worked out. But I had just been in the habit of speaking that way through an interpreter. And then I also could usually know what he was saying before he said it. It gave me extra time to think. The best part was the interpreter was so bad that the government provided that if I wanted the jury to hear some extra emphasis, I would speak quickly and loudly, and the interpreter said he couldn't hear it. Then I would get to say it a second time, even slower, so the jury got to hear it a second time. So it actually helped me emphasize the case and really enhanced the cross-examination of the butcher.
Where's the butcher now?
So to my knowledge, the butcher has been executed, but I would have to look into that. But I'm pretty sure that he got the death penalty that year. And in Iraq, once the appellate system has been exhausted, as soon as the appellate remedies have been exhausted, the execution has to take place within the lunar cycle. It's just a weird thing of Arab law. That's why when we handed over Saddam, he was killed so quickly, executed so quickly, because they had to kill him before the lunar cycle. And we did that on purpose. I say we as a coalition forces. Right. I wasn't there, but we had to do that so he wouldn't have a chance to escape.
Oh, Again, I would never even think about that. It's just amazing what we can learn from you, someone that's been over there, from what we saw, you know, sanitized on the news. I use sanitized, but getting that firsthand information. So when you wrapped it up over there, you wound down, you had cases to close out. Did you finish up everything? How did you get the word that you're going back to the States?
Right. So what was unfortunate, I had put in actually to stay for another year or another 6 months. I wanted to stay for a full year. That my, it was called a Noble Eagle number, had already been selected. So it was, you know, they jokingly was like, it would take an act of Congress to reverse that. So then I wanted to go to Afghanistan to be a prosecutor in Afghanistan. There weren't billets in Afghanistan. So I was basically dragged kicking and screaming back to the United States. But it made it all worth it because within 3 days, I got the case with a Navy SEAL falsely accused. So I got to go over and represent the Navy SEAL who just, you know, months before was in Iraq. Again, I wasn't with them, but we were in Iraq at the same time, and I was prosecuting their cases. So it kind of brought everything full circle. But I would have stayed in Iraq longer. I mean, I was really enjoying it. It wasn't nice being away from the United States, but you had a mission, you had something to accomplish. I don't think there's any way you could argue that there was something more valuable that a JAG could be doing other than prosecuting terrorists. And I can tell you that if it ever came up that I would be able to go back to Iraq or anywhere else and prosecute terrorists, it would be really hard to say no.
Now, my understanding is you were a magisterial district judge or justice.
Yes.
Did you go into the legislature before the Senate? Were you a representative first?
No. So I got out of the Navy. So after my time in Iraq the second time, I was promoted to officer in charge of Texas and Oklahoma. So I did that for 2 years, flew all over the United States litigating cases for the Navy. Incredible assignment. I then got out of the Navy, came back home to Pittsburgh. My idea was to be a federal prosecutor is what I really wanted to do. There was a hiring freeze called the sequester, if you remember.
I do.
So I was biding my time doing civil litigation, got approached to run for district judge, ran for district judge, won. My area was fairly Democratic and I won as a Republican. So then when Matt Smith, my predecessor, resigned, the Republican Party said, you could probably win this district. I was nominated to run. I won in the special election in 15, won in the general election in 16, and I'm not up again until 2020.
So. Gotcha. Now, what can you take, or what have you taken from your time in the service and over in Iraq into your time as a magisterial district justice and in the state Senate? What is translated well?
Well, there's almost too many to list. For one is leadership. I was in my mid-20s in Baghdad doing all the special forces prosecutions. You can't beat that. Also, just putting things in perspective. You can say, I sometimes feel guilty because I'll say, man, I had a rough day. But any day is a good day when you don't have to worry about like getting blown up on the way to work, right? And then when the person across from you doesn't literally want to kill you. So a lot of people ask me, well, you're really young. Would you get intimidated in Harrisburg? For 6 months, I sat this close to terrorists. Yeah. Nothing someone's gonna say or is gonna bother me. And also, a lot of the elected officials and politicians get super emotional, hyper emotional, take things personally. After prosecuting terrorists in Iraq, you learn you can't be hyper emotional because the person across from you wants to kill you and blow up your compatriots, right? So if you let that get in your way, you're going to have a very clouded judgment. You're going to lose the case. So one, do not get emotional. Two, things are in perspective. You may have a political opponent. That political opponent is not your enemy. Is not your enemy at the end of the day. You can go out and have a drink with that person, and that's fine. So it really brings a lot of gravity, leadership, perspective to the job. And frankly, it leads to civility, right? One of the things that really bothers me is how the parties treat themselves as they are the enemy. I've seen members of Al-Qaeda, like, that's the enemy, right? That person just has a different political opinion than you. It's not that big of a deal. We're going to work through it, so.
Guy, I could go on for 2 hours, 3 hours, and 4 hours with you. You were an excellent, excellent guest. I certainly do appreciate it.
Thanks, Tom.
You for your service, number one, as a naval officer, for what you did for our country over there and in the States. And I wish you the best of luck in your continued political career. And thank you very much for taking time out of your busy schedule to be on this show.
Thanks, Tom. I appreciate it. Thanks so much.
Once again, folks, this is Tom Gellis. This was Veterans Perspective, and we'll see you again next time.